If you don't know me, I'm Professor Bradford Hawes. I'm the Director of the Honors Program and the Interim Chair of the English Department. As many of you know, we are celebrating the 10th year of the Honors Program here at Washington Avis University, and we've had a number of cultural events that have been open to the campus community and the local community. And this is our first event for the spring semester. It's probably good that we didn't have a lot of things scheduled before now because of all the weather issues that we've been having, and it's good that we're not having another sub-zero night tonight. I'm really excited to introduce Warren Shaw to you. Warren and I have met under some unusual circumstances that we're both musicians. I'm an amateur musician. He's been a professional musician. But we share a love of culture and music, and we've had an interesting dialogue. And when I discovered that he was not only a practicing attorney, but also a social and cultural historian focusing on New York City, where he's from, I like that sense of place. You know, and I've been telling him about my experience with this locale because, you know, this is really where I'm from, and I know this place like he knows New York. And so when I was looking at his website, warrenshawhistorian.com, I encourage you to visit it, I was looking at all of the different subjects that he's covered, and one of them struck me as something that would work really well for our campus because we celebrate Black History Month, but we also are interested in African-American literature, African-American history, which is being taught right now. And of course, whenever you study American literature, that's going to be part of this. We're studying a little bit about African-American art in Literature 236 right now. So this is something that is tied to our curriculum. And of course, we need to be aware of these important social movements. So when I saw that, I thought that would be a nice connection between his expertise in New York and some of the things that matter to our community as well. So without further ado, I'd really like you to welcome Mr. Warren Shaw.
Thank you, Professor, and hello everyone, and welcome. I'm really delighted to see you. It's an honor to be here with you tonight to discuss the Harlem Renaissance. Let me talk to you a little bit about what I want to accomplish tonight. The Harlem Renaissance is usually described as a sort of a surge of creativity that took place within the African-American community in New York City during the 1920s, and that's not at all incorrect, but it's incomplete. What I'd like to do today is put the Harlem Renaissance in a larger context of evolving relationships between the races in the United States, talk a little bit more in detail about what the Harlem Renaissance was, what its founders intended to do, what actually happened within it, what brought it to an end, and what its legacy is for us today. And it really is much more than a surge of creativity. I will tell you, and then I'm going to show you, that the Harlem Renaissance is the hinge between the really inhuman sort of racial cartoon that was the dominant images of African Americans before the Harlem Renaissance. It was the Harlem Renaissance that put the close to those, made them a part of American history as opposed to ongoing American reality, and moved American culture into something much closer to what we're still living with today, where instead of an unbridgeable divide, we have and I'm hardly going to say that things are fine, simple, and easy here, but at least we're all on the same page, we're all human beings. There are people who would have argued that once upon a time. And it was the Harlem Renaissance more than anything else that separates us from that period in American history. And more than that, though, even more than that, the Harlem Renaissance redefined African American culture and even what it means to be an American for all Americans. So let's get started. And where we have to start is, slavery and the minstrel tradition. Let's go to our first slide. Success. Here's the thing. There are many, many immigrant groups that have come to the United States. At least 30 different groups represented by more than a million people apiece are presently living in the United States. However, no immigrant group has a history even remotely like that of African American people who were brought here involuntarily as commerce. And even worse than that, the form of slavery that evolved in the United States was a particularly brutal one. Slavery is very widespread in human history. Most of the time, though, it pertains to peoples who've been subjugated in war, individuals who've run afoul of someone who's powerful, that kind of thing. Typically, it's limited in time. It's not applicable to the children of those people, and it doesn't deprive the enslaved person of all rights. But that's what we had here pretty quickly. We had a racially rooted form of slavery that was absolute, that was inherited, that gave no legal protection to the people who were enslaved. That is a really horrible burden, and it's a burden that's very hard to live with, and it's a burden that's very hard to justify. Just as people who go into war have to be trained to become killers, American slave owners and whites in general had to be trained to accept this situation, to blind themselves to its brutality. And that needed a lot of reinforcement. What am I getting at? Bigotry. American bigotry was the cultural meme that Americans developed in order to live with the system of slavery that we had. So we had all of these sort of elaborate pseudoscientific nonsense ideas about the differences between blacks and whites, and by the middle of the 19th century, we had a very elaborate sort of parody of the slave class that we now call minstrelsy or minstrel shows. And the function of the minstrel show was to reinforce bigotry, was to a weight keeping the system in place. Here's an example of a poster advertising a minstrel show. And when I say that minstrelsy was big business, it was the first original performing arts form that was distinctive to the United States. To this day, it's the basis for a lot of American humor, a lot of American music. A lot of the songs that you think of, if you think of old American songs, are minstrel songs, like Camp Town Races. That's a minstrel song. And when I say that it was big business, by 1845 or so, there were 10 full-time minstrel troupes in New York City alone. It was the main form of show business for half a century, into the 20th century. And we don't really have any films of actual minstrel shows, but what I have for you now is a video clip that recreates some of the forms of the minstrel show. It consists of two performers, a white woman and a white man. The man's in blackface, and you'll see, you know, what the imagery of African Americans is from this piece pretty quickly. And don't hate yourself if, in spite of yourself, you find parts of it funny. Okay, there's a reason why minstrel shows had such enduring power, and it isn't just that they were ugly and brutal. And with that, let's see it.
Now, too quiet, people. Cotton, watch that chick.
Lena, let that be a lesson to you.
What's the matter with you boys shooting up that man's hen house?
I'll shoot any chicken trying to follow me home.
Well, why don't you get a job and go to work?
No, let got me a job this morning.
Where?
I went down to the post office and asked that man, could he let me have one of them jobs as a letter toter?
No, Cotton, you mean a mail carrier.
And the man said, boy, if you give me a situation, he'd have to put me through a simple self-examination.
No, stupid. You mean a civil service examination.
Well, the man carried me in a little room and set me down and started asking me a gang of questions.
Well, what'd he ask you?
First thing the man asked me, say, how far is it from the sun to the moon?
He asked you how far it was from the sun to the moon?
Yeah, that's what the man asked me.
Well, what'd you tell him?
I told him he was going to give me that route. I didn't want to go.
Well, Joe, how would you like to go to work for me?
Yeah. Ma'am, how much you gonna pay me, I hope?
Well, let's see now. Mm-hmm. I'll pay you all your worth.
No, ma'am, I gotta have some money.
You know, Cotton, I'm making a picture called The Lion Tamer.
The Lion Tamer?
Uh-huh.
There ain't but one kind of lion I'll mess with.
What kind's that?
Ooh, that's a dandelion.
Now, all I want you to do is meet me at the zoo in the morning at 9 o'clock.
Yeah, with the rest of the monkeys.
With the rest of the monkeys.
Yeah, I'll bring my grandpa with me.
I want to get a moving picture of you in the lion's cage.
Well, if you ever do get a picture of me in the lion's cage, you'll be moving all right.
Oh, Cotton, the lion can't hurt you.
Can't hurt me. Why, nobody make me hurt myself.
Why, the lion's tame. He'll eat right off your hand.
Eat off of your hand, uh-huh, and over your leg, too. I know them cats.
But you don't understand, Cotton. The lion was raised on milk.
Raised on milk? Uh-huh. I was, too, but I eat pork chops now.
Why, he can't bite you.
Now, how come he can't bite me?
He hasn't got a tooth in his head.
I know, but he can gum me to death. I don't want him gnawing on me.
Now, all I want to do is snap you as you enter the lion's cage.
You just want to snap me as I enter?
Yes.
Well, you better snap me as I enter, because you will never be able to focus me when I start out, because I'm Alabama bound.
So, in miniature, that's the legacy that the Harlem Renaissance was fighting against, okay? The big turning point in American history for our purposes tonight should be the Civil War, right? I mean, it was the Civil War that led to the end of slavery. But the war was a failure in terms of actually freeing African Americans, right? I mean, after the war ended in 1865, for the next 11 or 12 years was a period known as Reconstruction, when the federal government had a powerful presence in the former slaveholding states, or actually the rebelling states of the South, and there were efforts to actually create social change. For that period, former slave children went to school in greater numbers than whites in a number of states. A couple of them got elected to public office. But then, for political and economic reasons, about 1877, the federal government left, Reconstruction ended, and it was at that point that you suddenly had the rise of the Ku Klux Klan and Jim Crow and separate but equal, and a very violent dismantling of those changes. These were shattering disappointments for the nation's African American population, and really just terrible. But it was out of these developments that the preconditions for the Harlem Renaissance actually developed. So let me give you a couple of examples of what I mean. First of all, African American culture began to take on the forms that that are still defining for us today, like the music of the blues, which was which evolved in among the rural poor of deep southern states like Mississippi, as a way to, you know, just make life a little bit easier. Music has a way of doing that. All you needed was a voice and a guitar, and by the turn of the 20th century, blues was becoming refined into the form that we still know it, the 12-bar form, and so forth. The other important artistic development of this period for our purposes today is jazz, which developed in the late 19th century out of a fusion of the Creoles of Louisiana, who had had historically, you know, a certain amount of prestige in the social hierarchy of that state, but they lost those privileges after the end of Reconstruction. They found themselves living with much poorer people, and they brought their musical training and their respect for European musical forms with them, and that sort of combined with blues and produced the beginnings of what we now call jazz. And here's an example of an early jazz band, complete with an early drum kit, with a scene painted on the front, which was very kind of standard at the time. Okay, so we had those two artistic developments. The other thing that happened sociologically was the emergence of a post-slavery elite amongst the African-American population, made up mostly of physicians, dentists, educators, preachers, some business people, lawyers, morticians. This was a very, very small group of people. Here's a photograph of the first class of Virginia State in 1882. And to give you an example of just how small a group I'm talking about, in 1917, out of a total population of 10 million African Americans, 10 million, 2,100 were in college. Maybe 50 were in white colleges. So this was a very small and therefore very fragile group of people. So they were cautious. I mean, these were not, you know, people who were you know, making fiery speeches, but they were important nonetheless. And we will hear exactly what they did that was so important in a couple of minutes. So these were background circumstances that led to the Harlem Renaissance. The immediate circumstances that led to the Harlem Renaissance was, first of all, the Great Migration from the South. Not surprisingly, as soon as railroads and other transportation made it practical, African Americans began to leave the South behind. By 1920, 700,000 had left the South, and they'd gone, depending on where they started, as this map indicates, they'd gone to northern cities and western cities in various parts of the country. The other big circumstance was World War I, because more than 300,000 African Americans served in the armed forces. Several all-black fighting units were created, and they found themselves for the first time in centuries, you know, in an environment in which color was not an automatic badge of inferior caste, because Europe, for all the racial tension that they've had, it has not been a matter of skin color. And in fact, the French nicknamed these all-black fighting units the Hellfighters, because they compiled such an incredible, heroic record during the period of fighting. And this accomplishment, the Hellfighters' accomplishment, led to a certain degree of newfound respect among whites. And this was shown particularly when the black fighting units came home from the war in 1919 and had a big veterans march, you know, victory parade, as New York traditionally has done. And they went up Fifth Avenue, attended by the governor, Al Smith, the great newspaperman, William Randolph Hearst, and millions of whites. Here's a photograph from that march in 1919. A little dark, I'm sorry about that. And here's a quote from the New York Tribune describing this event. Up the wide avenue they swung. Their smiles outshone the golden sunlight. In every line, proud chests expanded beneath the medals valor had won. The impassioned cheering of the crowds massed along the way drowned the blaring cadence of their band. The old 15th was on parade, and New York turned out to tender its dark-skinned heroes a New York welcome. Never have white Americans accorded so heartfelt and hearty a reception to a contingent of their black countrymen. So this was something different. And where were these marchers headed up Fifth Avenue? They were heading to Harlem. And it's at this point in 1919 that Harlem becomes a part of our story. And let's turn to a photograph of Harlem. This is about 1923 on 125th Street. Harlem, as we know it today, started off as a more or less upper middle class kind of suburban community in the 1880s and 1890s. It was all white at that point. The transformation into Harlem, as it's recalled, and you know, Harlem from the 1920s, began in 1904 when two important things happened. First, the subway opened up and the neighborhood became accessible to commuters. Two, a man named Philip Peyton, a real estate developer, African-American, had a company known as the Afro-American Realty Company, bought a couple of apartment buildings and began renting vacant units to blacks. Some people have suggested that he was applying Booker T. Washington's motto that blacks could make it in America if the race got a bank book. And he was really successful. And, you know, the not so happy side of the story is that as blacks moved in, whites moved out. But on the other hand, that meant that by 1915, there were 50,000 blacks living in Harlem. And a sociological fabric grew that had never before been seen in the United States. It was almost a city in itself. Instead of just a servants class or something like that, you had an elite class, you had a middle class, you had a working class, you had churches, volunteer organizations, you had racial advocacy groups like the NAACP and the National Urban League headquartered there with monthly magazines, The Crisis and Opportunity, that served as vehicles for mass communication. So you had the first autonomous, socially integrated black community in the United States. Even the police officers in the area were black. This was brand new, and it began to create a sort of a euphoria. So all this good stuff was going on in New York City in 1919, but there was a horrifying contrast in the rest of the country. In contrast to the friendly environment in New York City, relatively speaking, was a summer that came to be known as the Red Summer. Whites rioted against blacks in at least 36 cities across the United States. There were at least 43 lynchings, and veterans in uniform were particular targets. This sounds really bizarre, right? Why attack veterans, people who fought for their country and lived to come back? Why do that? I mean, here's this horrible photograph. And let me just point out, look at this photograph. It is, you've got men, women, you've got some young kids, people smiling like it's funny or something. So what was going on? Why all this violence? I will tell you, I think this is the other side of the Great Northern Migration and the progress that blacks had made in finding work and making themselves a part of the new industrial economy of the North. Millions of whites came back from the war to find that the world had changed. Plus, you had a bad recession after the war, you had inflation, you had political repression because the left wing was very powerful in the country at this time. This was when you had the first Red Scare to try to tamp down all of that working class revolutionary fervor. And this was all part of that. They didn't want this social change. They wanted to have the world the way it was when they left to go fight. That's the way I understand why the Red Summer happened at the time that it did. Nonetheless, a disaster, right? Just this horrible thing, riots across the country. And in reaction against the Red Summer, and buoyed up by the very different events that were happening in New York City, the African-American elite, particularly in Harlem, decided to launch a campaign. And what was this campaign? Was it a frontal political assault against bigotry? No, it most certainly wasn't. The elite of that time decided, and I'm sure accurately, that such a frontal assault couldn't possibly get anywhere. And I will tell you that as the African-American population of New York City grew, their political power didn't increase at all. There was more than enough racism in New York City to make sure that that did not happen. The details of that are a little beyond our scope today, but take my word for it, political power was just not available. What happened instead? Well, they decided to launch a fine arts campaign. In other words, to develop literature, poetry, painting, and sculpture among African Americans. Now, why is that? Well, first of all, this was clearly understood to be a matter of politics by other means. Rather than a political frontal assault, they were doing a flanking maneuver through culture and beauty. As W.E.B. Du Bois put it, and he's really one of the founding minds of the Harlem Renaissance and the first black graduate of Harvard, by the way, there he is as a young man. As he put it, until the art of the black folk compels recognition, they will not be rated as humans. Well, by creating a body of work, that view meant that they would be rated as humans. So why fine arts? Well, you know, it takes money to have fine art. It takes money to be a sculptor, certainly. You can go back at any time in history, and painters and sculptors have needed patrons, people to support them while they did their work. For that reason, there wasn't a whole lot of visual art, and certainly not much sculpture, among African Americans to that point in American history. As for literature and poetry, remember, there was a concerted effort for most of the slavery years to prevent blacks from learning how to read, and that certainly makes literature, you know, impossible, right? So, this was the plan. As W.E.B. Du Bois put it again, "By the God of heaven, we are cowards and jackasses if, now that the war is over, we do not marshal every ounce of our brain and brawn to fight a sterner, longer, more unbending battle against the forces of hell in our own land. We return. We return from fighting. We return fighting." And that's how the Harlem Renaissance began. And there were two parts to this Harlem Renaissance. There was the fine arts side, which we're going to talk about now, and there was the popular culture side. The fine arts side was the deliberate creation of this elite. And how did it create this scene out of basically almost nothing? It sought out, and its leaders sought out and discussed and encouraged potential promising artists and funded them by awards competitions, by prizes, by publicizing them in those magazines I mentioned, and through personal subsidies. And here's where it gets a little complicated. These efforts were funded largely by white patrons. People like, William Dean Howells and other leading more progressive whites of the time. And this fine arts campaign was really very successful. Enduring talent was discovered and promoted, and enduring art was created. I'm thinking now of people like Aaron Douglas, who was often referred to as the father of visual arts among African Americans. Writers and poets like Langston Hughes and Counte Cullen, who we're gonna talk about now. Now, Langston Hughes was a man from the middle of the country who grew up under difficult circumstances. His poetic talent surfaced at a very young age, and I'm gonna read you now a brief poem that he wrote while he was in high school, which is still read to this day, and boy, that's precocious. The name of this poem is "The Negro Speaks of Rivers." And what I wanna point out to you, just before I even get to it, is it doesn't really follow traditional European poetic forms. It doesn't particularly rhyme. It uses vernacular, you know, sort of regular American speech. In the modernist vein, you know, he was not trying to create art in the classical vein. He was trying to create art for that would be intelligible and received by ordinary people. And here it goes. And in here, he was speaking on behalf of all African Americans. I've known rivers. I've known rivers ancient as the world and older than the flow of human blood in human veins. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. I bathed in the Euphrates when dawns were young. I built my hut near the Congo and it lulled me to sleep. I looked upon the Nile and raised the pyramids above it. I heard the singing of the Mississippi when Abe Lincoln went down to New Orleans, and I've seen its muddy bosom turn all golden in the sunset. I've known rivers, ancient dusky rivers. My soul has grown deep like the rivers. So in this poem, he's speaking on behalf of all African Americans and trying to synthesize their history globally and chronologically, and to make the reader feel the weight and the power and the diversity of it. On a much different plane, though without a terribly different intention, in that this piece also speaks on behalf of all African Americans, but it does so using traditional European references and forms. On the other hand, it's written in such a way as to kind of disguise them. If you look at this poem on the page, you can see that the lines are in regular meter and the rhyming scheme is regular. But because of the rhythm of the prose, it kind of disguises that. Nonetheless, you'll see there are references to Greek mythological figures and so forth. So this poem is called Yet Do I Marvel by Count A. Cullen. I doubt not God is good, well-meaning, kind. And did he stoop to quibble, could tell why. Why flesh that mirrors him must someday die. Make plain the reason tortured Tantalus is tainted by the fickle fruit. Declare, if merely brute caprice dooms Sisyphus to struggle up a never-ending stair. Inscrutable his ways are, and immune to catechism by a mind too strewn with petty cares to slightly understand what awful brain compels his awful hand. Yet do I marvel at this curious thing, to make a poet black and bid him sing. Also, a very ambitious work, right? So we have, very quickly, in Harlem, something happening that had never been seen before. And note the use of the American black vernacular, the references to Africa, and the visual artists were also making references to Africa. And this did two things. One, it reclaimed the ancestral heritage. Very important. It also claimed parity with cutting-edge European artists like Picasso and Matisse. If they could refer to Africa, then surely African Americans could too. And by using this common reference, they were claiming parity with people who were being acknowledged worldwide as masters. You see where I'm going? Now, one of the fathers of this whole movement was a man named Alain Locke. Actually, his name was Alan Locke. But he went to France and he liked it there so much that forever after he told people to pronounce his name in the French vein. So we're going to call him Alain Locke. And here's a photo of him. Nope, that's Langston Hughes. Forgive me, I forgot to advance. That's Langston Hughes as a young man. That's Count A. Cullen as a young man. And here we have Alain Locke looking rather challengingly and skeptically, I would say, at the camera. He's best remembered these days for a book that appeared in 1925 called The New Negro, which was sort of the manifesto of the Harlem Renaissance, an attempt to set forth the ideas underlying the fine arts campaign. As he put it in the book, his goal is to register the transformations of the inner and outer life of the Negro in America that have so significantly taken place in the last few years. Forgive the use of the word Negro, you know, these words have shelf lives. At the time, that was the polite word. It is no longer. That's the word he used, and I want to respect that. But when I speak of African Americans, I'm going to use terms that are acceptable to us today. You see what I mean? Okay. Anyway, his starting point, of course, was the rejection of what he called the old Negro. And what was the old Negro? Well, the old Negro was the whole sort of minstrel complex, the not quite human, the not, no ambition, the whole business. That out the window. Quite the contrary of that lesser imagery, Alain Locke argued and documented in this book, and oh, here's a picture of the cover of that book. Cover art by a Harlem Renaissance artist, I should say. He argued that because of their history and the suffering that they had experienced and the stamina that they had developed, that African Americans have a unique perspective on America and that they bring to America unique artistic and spiritual resources. He asserted racial dignity, self-definition, self-expression, not being told by others who you are, finding it out for yourself, a striving after what he called spiritual emancipation. He rejected submission to segregation and lynchings. And this was something of a frontal assault, but it was in the form of a long academic book written in formal English. Not at all, you know, the sort of street speech or kind of thing that might attract repression. Okay, I want to talk now, I want to focus on a man who I see as sort of the exemplar of the fine arts side of the Harlem Renaissance, and that is Paul Robeson. Who here has heard of Paul Robeson? Raise your hands. Okay. I would say 10% of the room raised hands. I'm really, really glad you're here today, because this is somebody you really must know about. First, let's get a photo. That's a young Paul Robeson wearing what was then a football uniform. Paul Robeson was the son of an escaped slave who became a minister. And he came from a family with a lot of drive, and he brought that drive with him. He started attending Rutgers University about 1915, and he began to play football and other sports. He was a very gifted athlete, and lest you think he was welcomed with open arms in view of the record that he compiled there, which I'm going to tell you about in a minute, the first time he played football, his own teammates broke his nose. Nice. Right, nice. By the time he graduated Rutgers in 1919, he was the valedictorian of the school. He had been accepted into the Phi Beta Kappa Society for accomplishment in the liberal arts. He had achieved varsity letters in 12 different sports. Okay, my father told me about Paul Robeson when I was about 8, and his concluding line to me was, if Paul Robeson had been white, he would have been president. And I think that's right. Somebody like this comes along very rarely. And then he went to Columbia Law School to be a lawyer, and dig this, while he was going to law school, he supported himself playing pro football with the NFL. Okay? And he graduated law school and he joined a New York law firm, and here's a photo of him as a young attorney. You know what? He didn't really like being a lawyer. I know what he means. But that's another subject. I suspect it didn't take all that much persuading by the members of the Harlem elite to talk him into leaving the law for a career on stage. He had already shown considerable promise as a singer and had only a little bit of acting experience, and yet, within a few years, this gifted man turned out to be gifted in these areas as well, he developed an international reputation as an actor and a singer. But the point that I want to make right now is he did so from the fine arts perspective, not the pop culture perspective. In other words, he became best known for appearing on Broadway as Othello. He became famous for his renditions of spirituals. He wasn't a jazz musician. He didn't do pop music. He did do some Broadway show tunes, but you know that has roots in Western formal music more than the vernacular of America. So he was a famous and very highly respected figure. We're going to hear some music from him in a moment. But this is where things get complicated, because he had absorbed the political ideals that were under the surface, rarely spoken of overtly, but were there, the political ideals of the Harlem Renaissance. And the drive for social justice led him to become the prototype of the left-wing activist performer that we are now, you know, really quite familiar with. He visited the Soviet Union during the Depression, and he proclaimed that it worked. He met Stalin. He said, "I have no problem with the Soviet Union. They have no problem with me." And he had a point there, you know? Racism was not an issue there. He became an outspoken critic of American racism, and later on of the Cold War, and this is where he got into trouble. The State Department revoked his passport from 1950 to 1958. For the peak of his career, his livelihood was destroyed. The federal government started a concerted campaign, and they succeeded in virtually erasing him from public awareness, which is why you guys have not heard of this amazing man. So let's hear some of his music. I'm going to play you a song that he recorded in the 1940s called "The House I Live In." And you may be surprised as you listen to it to learn that it is a patriotic anthem. It is a fervent love song to the United States. But if you listen closely, you'll see that what he's praising about the United States are the ideals, democracy and freedom, and the spirit of the people of the United States. It's a very selective list, because like many left-wing activists in America, Paul Robeson's love of country was expressed more in terms of what the country could be rather than in terms of what it actually was. So let's now hear "The House I Live In."
The flag I see, a certain word, a democracy. What is America to me? The house I live in, the friends that I have found, the folks beyond the railroad, and the people all around. The worker and the farmer, the sailor on the sea, the men who built this country, that's America to me. The words of old Abe Lincoln, of Jefferson and Payne, of Washington and Jackson, and the tasks that still remain. The little bridge at Concord, where freedom's fight began, our Gettysburg and Midway, and the story of the tan. The house I live in, my neighbors white and black, The people who just came here are from generations back. The town hall and the soapbox, the torch of liberty, a home for all God's children, that's America to me. The house I live in, the goodness everywhere, a land of wealth and beauty, with enough for all to share. A house that we call freedom, the home of liberty, but especially the people, that's America to me. But especially the people, that's the truth, America.
So let's talk about the pop culture side of the Harlem Renaissance. The pop culture side emerged very differently. Rather than being the deliberate creation of the African-American elite, the pop culture move side of the Harlem Renaissance emerged as a result of the sudden upsurge by whites in black culture after the end of the war. We're going to talk about why that is later. But the point is that it drew upon the pre-existing cultural strengths in music and singing and dancing. And it was funded by commercial audiences and commercial interests in show business rather than by white patrons via African-American elites. And one of the big impetus, one of the kickoffs for this whole side of it was a musical called Shuffle Along, that appeared in 1921, written by Ubi Blake and Noble Sissel. There are the two of them there on the bottom. This is the cast photo. It was the first all-black major Broadway musical in decades, and it was a huge hit, so much so, with white audiences, I should say, that it caused curtain time traffic jams. This musical started the career of Josephine Baker, who you may have heard of. There she is doing the Charleston. And it spawned a whole string of successor musicals, all black musicals, over the next decade. Point I want to make about this play, other than the effect that it had, is two of the songs, I'm Just Wild About Harry, and How Are You Gonna Keep Him Down on the Farm After They've Seen Paris, these became two of the biggest hits for the entire era. You know, for a lot of people, if you think of the words, I'm just wild about Harry, you'll hear the melody. I'm just wild about Harry, and so forth. I'm no singer, just a drummer. And what's more, the most characteristic dance of the 20s, the Charleston, was introduced in a play called Running Wild, a successor to Shuffle Along, which was a spinoff that was written by the great Harlem stride pianist James P. Johnson. These songs and this dance are African-American creations. But whereas in the past in America, whites had shown interest in black culture only decades later and usually in some sort of parody form, as in minstrelsy, here, in this point, they instantly became definitive works for the entire era for whites. So you can see something different was going on, okay? Now, on a perhaps less exalted level, some of this interest by whites was stimulated by Prohibition and by Harlem's role as a hotbed of speakeasies and by a whole string of whites-only tourist traps that opened in Harlem, like the Cotton Club, the most elite of them all. This was a very expensive nightclub that was popular with the town's elites and diplomats and visitors and tourists who had plenty of money to spend and that kind of thing. The patrons were all white. The staff and performers were all black. You will not hear me say that the Harlem Renaissance produced an instant revolution, but that's not my point tonight. So, in order for you to get a sense of how major the Cotton Club was in its era, I have a couple of
visual artifacts for you to look at. Here we have a program from the Cotton Club in its heyday. Notice, I mean, there's Cab Calloway. He was the featured performer of the night. Notice the white patrons, the non-white performers. A little hard to tell who's who, but trust me on that. You know, but you know what I mean. And now I mentioned before the visual art of the Harlem Renaissance. Let's see a couple of pieces. This is whoop. This is a very well-known painting by Archibald Motley of Harlem nightlife. Take a couple of seconds to look at that. You can see it's very modernistic. It's very vividly colored. There's a lot of movement. There's a lot of energy. The bartender looks maybe a little bit over it all. But the patrons certainly aren't. They're having a blast. And last, we have this sort of distinctly cubistic-looking painting of two dancers. I just think this is a fabulous work. Unfortunately, I can't remember who the artist is. Forgive me. But by these pieces, I want you to understand, to feel some of the energy of the nightlife of Harlem in this era. And the pop culture side of the Harlem Renaissance produced people like Duke Ellington and Fats Waller and Cab Calloway and Fletcher Henderson and Willie the Lion Smith and Bill Bojangles Robinson. You may have heard some of these names. What we're going to do now is we're going to see a couple of music videos just to get a sense of what this work sounded like. First, we're going to hear Duke Ellington's tune, It Don't Mean a Thing. And my point, before we get to that, let me just tell you a little about Duke Ellington and his band. Duke Ellington's orchestra was the house band for the Cotton Club for many, many years, most of the Harlem Renaissance era, and this high status is visible, as you'll see, in the high quality of the production, the elegance of the backdrop, the nice suits, the very polished performance. Ellington was very much loved by Harlem residents for his very personal artistry, his sort of easy, unflappable kind of charm. And let me also point out that he had a weekly radio broadcast from the Cotton Club. The Harlem Renaissance was beamed into the homes of Americans across the country thanks to the popularity of Duke Ellington. So let's see this and then we'll...
Mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
It don't mean a thing, all you gotta do is swing.
Makes no difference if it's sweet or hot. Just give that rhythm every little thing you've got.
It don't mean a thing if you ain't got that swing.
Thank you.
So, by contrast, in a moment, we're going to see a video from Fats Waller. Now, Fats Waller was a really great piano player, one of the greats in a period when piano virtuosity was very much in demand. And this video is a whole lot different than the very polished, sort of restrained, you know, proper-looking presentation that we saw in Duke's piece. This is a tune about a Harlem rent party. Now, this used to be a common way to pay the rent back in the old days when rents were cheap, but and still unaffordable, of course, if you don't have any money. But the point is, for a quarter or 50 cents, you could go into somebody's house, and you could eat, and you could drink, and you could be entertained by music, and at the end of the night, the host of the party would have enough money left over to pay the rent. That's why it was called a rent party. See? Okay. So that's what this piece is about. It's about a Harlem rent party. So it's got it's a casual setting. People are dancing. People are drinking. People are partying. In fact, the whole event seems to be threatening to break into chaos, and eventually it gets raided by the police, who start dancing too. So this piece really highlights the energy and the music and the dancing that Harlem became known for. On the other hand, it also, you know, brings out the sort of fringy, questionable connotations of the pop culture side of the Harlem Renaissance that made the Harlem Renaissance elites, the people on the fine arts side, a little uneasy at first. And, you know, we'll talk about that in a minute. First, let's see what Fats Waller has to say.
They have a new expression, long Harlem way, that tells you when a party is just not more than gay. To say that things are jumping, leave not a single doubt. Watch all these cats, watch everything when you hear somebody shout. This joint is jumping, really jumping. Come and catch and check your hands, I mean this joint is jumping. Piano's pumping, dancers are bumping. Every motion's on his toes, in fact, this joint is jumping. Check your weapons at the door to see a quarter. Burn your love around the floor, grab anybody's daughter. The roof is rocking, the neighbors are knocking, but we're all bums when the wagon comes. Let it leave, yes, let it dance, let me dance, and I love it. Oh, yes, get that boy a drink over there, he's all right. Fine lad, yes, That ain't the play, no. Look, leave that chick, that's my bro. Take it, Miss Johnson, take it.
This joint is jumping.
Yeah.
It's really jumping.
I know
it. Come and catch the take your hands. I mean, this joint is jumping. Hey, hey. Piano's thumping, dancers are bumping. Every bone is on his toes. In fact, the joint is jumping.
Tell him about it.
Take your weapons at the door. Now be sure to pay your quarter.
That's it, get
burn your lever on the poor boy. Grab anybody's daughter.
Except the roof
is rocking. The neighbors are knocking. Uh-huh. We're all bumps when the wagon comes. I mean, this joint is jumping.
Turn it loose. Big feet bend and there's plenty in the kitchen. What is that? They just walk in. Just look at the way it's switching. Oh, mercy. Don't mind out, cause I'm in power. I got little foot, yeah, I think this joint is jumping, yeah. Oh, don't ever do the right man. No, no, don't ever do that. I mean this joint is jumping, yeah.
So, you know, as great a pianist as he was, even more, he was a great entertainer and great songwriter. So like I said, the Harlem elite was, like, uneasy about the growth of the pop culture side, you know? But as they saw what a huge phenomenon it was, how much fame and how much it brought to Harlem and how much money it brought to Harlem, well, you know, they made their peace with it, let's put it that way. And for some years, during the 20s, the whole improbable sort of mangle of art and implied politics and the underlying bigotry and alcohol and glitter and gangsters, the artists and the drinkers and the gangsters and the gamblers and the madness of the Roaring Twenties, it all seemed to kind of work, to create a kind of euphoria, the period when, as Langston Hughes put it, the Negro was in vogue. And as one journalist put it, who wrote for the short-lived Harlem tabloid with a name that I absolutely love, it's sort of grand and smarmy at the same time, the Interstate Tattler. As she put it, what a crowd, all classes and colors met face to face, ultra-aristocrats, bourgeois, communists, Park Avenue galore, bookers, publishers, Broadway celebs, and Harlemites all giving each other the once-over. So, you know, this was the Harlem Renaissance at its peak, at least in legend and myth. Underlying that, there was the America's racial baggage is still with us, and it was certainly still there then. You know, I mean, the Cotton Club was, you know, Jim Crow, for God's sake. So the underlying racist baggage was stubborn. But so was the very carefully calibrated fight against it. And what I want to play you now is a music video by Louis Armstrong. Now, Armstrong's not generally thought of as a Harlem Renaissance artist. He's not generally thought of as politically active. And this piece is, you know, not explicitly political. On the contrary, what I want to point out to you is that in this setting, it's a really horrible video. I mean, you'll see that it's really a degrading environment visually. And how does Armstrong deal with the really awful setting that this video is put in? The answer is he ignores it. He gives a fantastic, heartfelt performance. There's no groveling, there's no genuflecting, there's nothing here but a man committed to his art and surrendering himself to it, and his greatness as an artist is visible in his face, visible in his motions, and he makes the degrading surroundings look ridiculous. Just ridiculous. This is a great artist, not some sort of a performing, you know, animal. And by the way, he's wearing a gold watch. Underneath the stupid costume they make him wear. There's one point where he looks right at the camera, and he's saying to you in this coded way, you know, I know this is ridiculous, you know this is ridiculous, but this is the world we live in, and as he sings in this song, just because I greet my troubles all with a smile. And that's the way he went through life. And he wasn't blind to the world that he lived in. But, you know, the people of that time could not wage a frontal assault, and they had to deal with their reality in other ways. And at one point, he raises his trumpet almost at a military angle, you know, like it's a weapon. I'm not saying he was suggesting violence. Instead, it's more like the sticker that Woody Guthrie had on his guitar. This machine kills fascists. That's the kind of weapon his trumpet was. So, let's see Louis Armstrong in this tune called Shine.
No figure in jazz is more world-renowned than the incomparable Louis Old Satchmo Armstrong. He of the gravel voice and liquid horn of Basin Street, New Orleans. Cradle of the Negro tradition in American jazz. Helped along on his way to the top by King Oliver in Chicago and Fletcher Henderson in New York, he soon eclipsed both masters and all rivals in reputation. For this film jazz parody on Paradise, Louis recorded his famous That's Why They Call Me Shine.
Oh, Johnny, drop that mean girl. My hair is pretty just because my teeth are burning. Oh, just because I always wear a smile. I like the dress in the latest style, ladies, guys. Just because I'm glad I'm living. Oh, I take all my troubles all with a smile. Just because my color shade makes difference. That's why they call me shine. We'll be right back.
because Lewis has been imitated for the better part of a century, I think it's important to explain his greatness on the trumpet because it's hard for us to hear it. When Louis Armstrong first hit the national scene, his virtuosity on the trumpet was so astounding that he was frequently accused of using a trick instrument. Nobody believed that a trumpet could actually be used that way. He hit notes higher than anybody had been able to hit on that instrument in centuries. And he did it so often that audiences took to counting the number of high C's, high D's, and high E's that he could hit in a row. He would do 50 or 60 of them. You know, so it's important to point that out. Okay, so now we have talked about the racist minstrel tradition that the Harlem Renaissance was targeted against. We've talked about the fine arts campaign. We've talked about the pop culture side of it, and we've talked about the social scene that emerged in Harlem during this period. But let's talk a little bit more about the culture of the Harlem Renaissance itself and some of the complexities of it. I mean, there are some problems with art as propaganda, which is really what the fine arts campaign was, okay? Let's be blunt about it. I mean, W.E.B. Du Bois was very flat out about it. He said, this is art for political reasons and I don't care what its content is and I don't want to hear from artists what they want to do. This is what you're going to do. But there's problems with that. I mean, what about the artist and their talent that you are ostensibly celebrating at the same time as you're putting a straitjacket on it? That's a problem. What about art as a commercial product, like Duke Ellington? I mean, he became a wealthy man from his music. But is that political or is it commerce? Is it free self-expression? What about the use of African-American vernacular versus classical European forms? If you use the vernacular, are you speaking for the people, or are you putting on an updated minstrel show? If you're using Western traditions, are you ignoring your own people's tradition, or are you showing in effect that we're Americans also? You see what I mean? It gets complicated. This is not simple. And all of this recalls W.E.B. Du Bois' observation about the divided souls of Americans of African descent, as he put it. It is a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness, this sense of always looking at oneself through the eyes of others. One ever feels his two-ness, an American, a Negro, two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideals in one dark body, whose dogged strength alone keeps it from being torn asunder. And still another level of complexity came from the dependence on white supporters and patrons. You know, William Harmon, an industrialist, founded the Harmon Foundation, which funded an annual awards campaign and gave exhibits to African-American visual artists, gave them a forum that was absolutely indispensable. On the other hand, none of those works sold. None of those artists were able to make a living, and for all the quality of their legacy, the dependence on white funding made it all a little bit questionable, a little bit self-questionable. Were the artists second-guessing themselves? Were they writing or creating works that they thought their funders would accept? And with this in mind, let me talk for a moment about one of these patrons in particular, Charlotte Osgood Mason, the so-called godmother. A Fifth Avenue socialite, millionaire, who funded Langston Hughes and Zora Neale Hurston, she invested more than $75,000 in young African-American artists, which is the equivalent of about $1 million today. Not a small amount of money, right? But she tended to break off these relationships when she felt that these artists were being disloyal to what she saw as the purity in their work. And while, you know, you can make a decent argument that if she's paying for the work, she's entitled to be a critic of the work, but on the other hand, you know, maybe she's not. Maybe if she's supporting an artist, she ought to let the artist do what the artist feels called to do. And because she believed in what we might call the cult of primitivism, which I'll talk about more in a moment, and because she disliked social protest, these rifts with her, the artists that she funded, these breaks were frequent. And with this in mind, I should point out the paradox that the Harlem vogue among whites, you know, their use of it as a sort of a tourist place to go and misbehave, this was a construct in its way that reinforced Jim Crow, like the Cotton Club, which was segregated, like the stores on 125th Street that wouldn't hire black people. You know, Harlem's own residents, by and large, hated this tourism business. And it was heavily promoted in much the same way that if you go to San Francisco to this day, you'll see people, you know, at Haight-Ashbury flogging the memories of the flower power era of the 1960s, which was centered there. You know what I mean? Some of this was really just artificial, just commerce. The big exception to this racial divide was the Savoy Ballroom. This was the one, wrong slide. This was the one place where whites and blacks could dance freely and mingle and hang out freely. Why there, I don't know. But let me just tell you a little about it. It was an enormous dance hall. It would hold several thousand people. And it was so popular that the wooden floor had to be replaced every 3 months. It was so big and so popular that it had two bands on two stages at either end of the room, so that when one band needed a break, the other band would start playing. And they hired the very best bands to be found. The house band was Chick Webb. Now, Chick Webb was one of the Harlem Renaissance greats. He was one of the great band leaders. He discovered Ella Fitzgerald and had a whole string of hit tunes. And I should point out that he was disabled. He had tuberculosis of the spine. He was a hunchback. He was maybe 4 feet tall, and yet he was the most powerful and articulate drummer of his era. He played opposite Benny Goodman, the white king of swing, and beat him. You know, so there was a lot going on in this. The cultural depths were not hard to find. And so in spite of these contradictions and these limitations and these questions, the Harlem Renaissance brought an astonishing breakthrough in African-American self-definition, in the relations between the races, and in white's view of the validity of African-American culture. And so why? Why were whites so interested in blacks in this new way? I mean, whites have been interested in blacks for a long time. That's why we had blackface. But why in this new way? Why in the 1920s did the Charleston become such a big thing with whites? Why did, I'm just wild about Harry. Why? What was so different? So what I want to do for a moment is just compare in sort of broad way the general state of black culture and white culture at the beginning of the post-World War I era. Blacks in general were excited, thrilled, overjoyed at the new possibilities, getting away from the South, the misery and the danger and the immobilization of the South and getting to the North, and the opening of Harlem gave these feelings a huge boost. So it's not surprising that the Harlem Renaissance became synonymous with an incredible surge of creativity and productivity among African Americans. By contrast, whites were deeply shaken and cynical in the wake of World War I. The war was widely seen as proof that civilization itself had failed. And this was reinforced by the revelations of Freud about interior drives and the thinness of the veneer of civilization, the centrality of sexuality in individual psychology. All of this reinforced the idea that maybe we weren't so civilized after all. On the other hand, whites feared that their culture had become so sentimentalized and so commercialized, so phony, that it had lost its way, that it had become dead. And they looked for something more vibrantly alive as a sort of salvation. This was the sort of matrix that led to what we now call the lost generation, the first wave of white bohemianism in Greenwich Village. There was because of all of these doubts, there was a need among whites in general. There were, a lot of them felt a sort of a need to connect with what they called primitive impulses. In other words, with hedonism, with satisfying appetites instead of denying them. And to connect with the body as opposed to the mind. And whites easily viewed blacks and black culture as a way to achieve these goals. And, you know, this view really wasn't all that inconsistent with racial bigotry, even if it required some updating. Now, much of white's post-war doubts got washed away in the prosperity and hedonism and drunkenness of the roaring 20s. But nonetheless, the white turn to Harlem, for all of the condescension that was implied in it, meant that whites were more prepared than ever before to encounter black culture on its own terms and to give it positive value and weight more than ever before in American history. And these were the circumstances that made possible the synergies and the interactions between whites and African Americans on a level that hadn't been seen before. And the Harlem Renaissance, in turn, was a part of the redefinition of the United States following World War I. What happened? Well, America became a majority urban society in the 1920s, and notice that the imagery of the Harlem Renaissance was completely urban, so it fit this new phenomenon with ease. Next, following the war, America became the globe's dominant economic and cultural power, and the rise of mass communications transformed American pop culture into a national and international force, and the effect of movies and radio and whatnot enlarged performers to larger-than-life status. And I think this was part of the reason why black performers were received so eagerly, because they benefited from this larger-than-life status as well. But because of all of this, the Harlem Renaissance got national and international attention. France went wild for black performers. Josephine Baker lived there for many years, and so on. So we had this really big and complicated phenomenon remaking much of American culture. Why isn't it still with us? Well, the answer is two things. The crash of 1929, which killed off a lot of the money that had funded the fine arts side, and the repeal of Prohibition a couple of years later, which killed off a lot of the businesses that supported the pop culture side. And in this newly somber environment of the Depression and no more speakeasies, the vogue for Harlem wanes among whites. The tourist trade shrank. There was a total loss of the Prohibition trade. Lots of job losses among ordinary residents. So the Harlem's economy really, it takes a big hit and it begins to deteriorate. I mean, you know. So in 1935 came the symbolic end of the era. The Harlem riot of 1935. This began with an incident of shoplifting on March 19th, 1935, when a 16-year-old kid gets caught trying to take a penknife from a store on 125th Street. There's a scuffle, and the teenager bites an employee's hand. The police and an ambulance are called. A rumor spreads that a 12-year-old has been beaten to death for stealing a piece of candy. And this kind of, you know, sets off accumulated resentment at the Jim Crowism of 125th Street and, you know, the white-owned stores, anger at the Depression and lots of things. You know, I mean, this was not a happy environment in a lot of ways. There was a lot of poverty. And the result was 24 hours of rioting. And, you know, it was difficult after that to maintain the image of Harlem as that carefree tourist mecca for slumming whites. In search of thrills and fun. I mean, you know, you can't have a renaissance when everybody's out of work. And so we have to see the 1935 as the end of the Harlem Renaissance. So let me sum up, and then I want to play you one last piece of music, and I'll explain why. The Harlem Renaissance was really a fundamental break with America's racial past. And it was a part of the tremendous reordering that overtook America after the end of what was then called the Great War. It was, of course, much less than a total victory over the historic forces that it contended with, But today, you know, almost 100 years later, it's really clear that the Harlem Renaissance marked a new era for all Americans. For blacks, through the Harlem Renaissance, they reclaimed their heritages as African Americans, as Americans, as African descendants. And they accumulated unequivocal, unimpeachable evidence of artistic quality that was used, that could be used to combat the minstrel and racist stereotypes, just as W.E.B. Du Bois had intended. For whites, through their participation in and their emulation of the black innovations of the Harlem Renaissance, they hoped to reclaim some measure of a more vital, exhilarating experience of beauty. For all Americans, in whites and blacks' acknowledgement of the value of these cultural innovations, they helped create a new sense of American self-belief in the value of its own culture, as opposed to the previous way of seeing America as the sort of junior sister to Europe. We stopped seeing ourselves that way, and in no small measure because of the Harlem Renaissance. Finally, by closing the door on minstrelsy and making it essentially impossible to deny some level of human equality among all Americans, the Harlem Renaissance set the stage for the more bluntly confrontational, the legal claim for rights that came into being in the 50s and 60s and started us on into the world we're in today. The generation that set the stage for the Renaissance, people like W.E.B. Du Bois and Alain Locke, and the generation that took that stage, people like Langston Hughes and Fats Waller and Robeson and so forth, they compiled a record of achievement that we can hope to emulate in our own time. These weren't giants, they were human beings. They were talented human beings, they were driven human beings, but they were just like us. Finally, I want to play you one more video, and I want you to see this thing as sort of epitomizing both the accomplishments and the limitations of the Harlem Renaissance. This is a video of Gene Krupa, the drummer and band leader, a song called Let Me Off Uptown. Now, quite honestly, it's a little bit cringeworthy, okay? It's a little bit cringeworthy. The conceit of this video is the skinny little white girl singer, Anita O'Day, is telling the older black trumpeter Roy Eldridge about how great Harlem is because he's never been there. Okay? It's a little cringeworthy. On the other hand, and this is, you know, these are white musicians who were big stars in their time playing music that is unquestionably of recent African-American invention. They're playing with a mixed band, and the chief soloist is a black man. Okay, so this is something that the pitch shows the advances that the Harlem Renaissance produced and also its limitations because of this cringeworthy quality, you know? Now, let me just point out, Anita O'Day, one of the hippest singers ever, she knew that this was BS. Krupa certainly did, and Eldridge certainly did. They all knew it, but they read the temper of the times. They were producing popular art, you know, in other words, stuff that would be consumed by an audience, and they judged correctly. This was Krupa's biggest hit. This song bought Krupa the home in Yonkers that he lived in for the rest of his life, okay? So as sort of dopey as this video is in some ways, see it for what it is, work for what it says, and understand that it was a big hit, okay? So this is the song, Let Me Off Uptown. Thank you.
my name's Roy.
Well, come here, Roy, and get groovy. You been uptown?
No, I ain't been uptown, but I've been around.
You mean to say you ain't been uptown?
No, I haven't been uptown. What's uptown?
Pleasure you're about, and you feel like stepping out. All you've got to shout is, let me off uptown. If it's rhythm that you feel, then it's nothing to conceal. All you've got to feel is, let me off uptown. Got those rib joints, got those tube joints, got those hip joints. Where could a fella go to top it if you want to pitch a ball and you can't afford a hole? All you've got to call is, let me off uptown.
Anita, oh Anita, say I feel something.
What you feel, Roy? The heat?
No, it ain't the heat. It must be that uptown rhythm, because I feel like blowing.
Well, blow, Roy, blow!
Mentioned that Anita O'Day attracted some controversy for dancing while standing next to Roy Eldridge. That was going a little too far. So, there we go. Thanks a lot. This has really been great.